so many of our members and friends lend their support above and beyond membership fees. Please give generously to the library so we can continue to build our collections and present wide-ranging programs. It gives me great pleasure to introduce Paul Muldoon. He was born in Northern Ireland in 1951 outside of the Moy, a place, as he said, burned into the retina that he still considers home. While an undergraduate at Queen's University, Belfast, he published his first collection of poetry, New Weather, in 1973. Graduating with an allowed fail, he, quote, ran away to the BBC, as poets did, and stayed there 13 years. Teaching followed at Cambridge, the University of East Anglia, and then the US, Columbia, the University of California, and UMass. In 1990, he arrived at Princeton, where he is now Howard G. B. Clark Professor in Humanities and the chair of the Lewis Center for the Arts, except for a five-year hiatus at Oxford from 1999 to 2004, where he was professor of poetry. He's received numerous fellowships, awards, honors, and prizes, and in 2003 won the Pulitzer for his poetry collection, Moist Sand and Gravel. Since 2007, he's been the New Yorker's poetry editor. He's prolific, inventive, and unexpected. Among his many works are three collections of his poetry, a number of anthologies, an adaptation of Aristophanes' The Birds, his lectures at Oxford collected into a marvelous book, The End of the Poem, and his two delightful and clever children's books, The Last Thesaurus and The Noctuary of Narcissus. As he says, I'm thinking about poetry all the time to a greater or lesser extent. He's known as a generous teacher. One of his students at Princeton called him the nicest guy in the building. He says of his teaching, I read my students' poems as I would John Donne's or Robert Frost's. The kind of teaching I do is very intense and intensive as it's happening. As a schoolboy, he sent his poems to Seamus Heaney, asking the poet to tell him where he was going wrong. Heaney wrote back saying that he didn't think he could tell him anything he wouldn't find out for himself. In his newest collection, he finds out for himself the full force of losing his mentor, Seamus Heaney, a fellow Northern Irish poet and friend who died in 2013. Bereavement is almost everywhere in 1,000 Things Worth Knowing. One reviewer said, the verse is a lot like grief. It gnaws away at the edges of your brain long after you think you've put it aside. Mm-hmm. Please join me in welcoming Paul Muldoon.
A la recherche du temps perdu. The human zoo and the human genome. The man who mistook his wife for a day in the life of ancient Rome. The Art of Singing by Enrico Caruso, A History of the Pirates, Robinson Crusoe. Hobbes' Leviathan, Tom Moore's Lalla Rook. I haven't seen the movie. What to expect the first year? The Three Musketeers, The Sign of Four, The Chronicles of Timbuktu, Robert Hughes and The Fatal Shore, Julius Caesar and his modus operandi, The Life and Opinions of Tristram Shandy, Paradise Regained, The Pentateuch. I haven't seen the movie. The book, You Tossed Me From Afar, like it was a brick, and doomed us to star in our own biopic. Dante's Il Purgatorio, the poems of Poe and Robert Frost, Fencing with the Sabre, the Division of Labour, Loves, Labours Lost, Aristotle, Onassis, and Maria Callas, Man and His Symbols, The Reign of the Phallus, The Geraldary Letter, The Journals of Captain Cook. I haven't seen the movie, but I've read the book. I thought I'd begin with that, since we are in one of the great libraries in the world, where people, thank heavens, are still reading the odd book, or maybe even buying the odd book and writing the odd book. And I am very pleased to be able to say that, thanks to mostly two people who are in this room, my parents-in-law, Anne and Burton Horowitz, we had the great pleasure, my wife, a special wife, were there, and it's a family thing, had the pleasure of living just down the street here on East 79th Street in 1987. So we're very intimate with this part of the world, and it's a delight to be here. So now that was in case you were wondering if I'd lost the couple of marbles you might have thought I had, and you're thinking, what the fuck was that? Now you're probably going to be thinking that anyway, and during the course of the next, 45 minutes or an hour. But what was that? It was a psalm lyric, which of course belongs to roughly the same family, I suppose. I suppose it would have the kind of relationship one to the other that an orangutan, say, might have to a baboon. I mean, I'm not being very specific about that. You know, they're similar, like a hippo and a rhino. And they're very difficult to tell apart. Very difficult, well, actually it's very difficult to define or describe the distinction between the two. But in the middle of the night, you probably would tell one from the other. Just as you probably would a rhino from a hippo, right? So they share some territory in common, the kind of grayness, and anyway, they in many cases. But so what I'm interested in, of course, is often the place at which the two overlap to some extent. But and I might read another song lyric later on. But I will begin with a poem. And what I'll do is read a poem set in that part of the world that you were hearing about, which is Northern Ireland. I was born there in 1951 in a little Catholic parish. And my mother was a school teacher. She taught what we called infants, kindergarten, I suppose, or grade school here. And we weren't quite from that part of the world. We were blow-ins. We came from about 10 or 15 miles down the road, which in that part of the world, and conceivably in this, actually, and I just come from Brooklyn, and it's only, 6 miles away, but it seems like a slightly different world to this spot here. And we weren't, in the country, of course, we weren't quite accepted. Partly because we were newcomers, blow-ins, partly because my mother was the teacher, and that was still an era when being a teacher or indeed a librarian, a doctor or a clergyman, still had some, what would one say, heft in the world. So there was also the fact that my mother didn't really want us to fraternize, quote unquote, with the locals, because she was very aware that many of them were engaged, even then in the 1950s, in militant republicanism. Mm-hmm. And I know you probably think that's something Donald Trump does, but in this case, the tradition of the Irish Republican Army, the nationalist cause, those who believed in violent action to further their ends, which was not something we were particularly interested in. We were not at all interested in. many of the people round about were interested in it, and I think she was very fearful, and I think rightly, that we might get caught up in it in some way. So that's a little background to this poem, which has a title from the Irish language. The Irish language, of course, in that part of the world, not the national language as it was, it is indeed in the Republic of Ireland. So when we used the language as kids, there was always a little bit of danger associated with it, you know? I didn't want to learn it at high school or grammar school, but basically, when the roll was called in the morning by the teacher, there was a particular formula, and it went along these lines. How are you on doing? Actually, the word is Anshaw. When the master was calling the roll at the primary school in College Lands, you were meant to call back Anshaw and raise your hand as your name occurred. Anshaw, meaning here and now, all present and correct, was the first word of Irish I spoke. The last name on the ledger belonged to Joseph Mary Plunkett Ward, and was followed, as often as not, by silence, knowing looks, a nod and a wink, the master's droll. And where's our little ward of court? I remember the first time he came back, the master had sent him out along the hedges to weigh up for himself and cut a stick with which he would be beaten. Yeah, that's how we lived. After a while, nothing was spoken. He would arrive as a matter of course with an ash plant, a sally rod, or finally, the hazel wand he had whittled down to a whiplash. Its twist of red and yellow lacquers, sanded and polished, and altogether so delicately wrought that he had engraved his initials on it. I last met Joseph Mary Plunkett Ward in a pub just over the Irish border. He was living in the open, in a secret camp on the other side of the mountain. He was fighting for Ireland, making things happen. And he told me, Joe Ward, of how he had risen through the ranks to quartermaster, commandant, how every morning at parade, his volunteers would call back Anshaw and raise their hands as their names occurred. So I'll read a moment set in that milieu, in this little Catholic parish. It's called Cuba. It's a poem about the impact of the Cuban Missile Crisis, even there, and which of course was considerable. Some of you may recall, I know one or two of you only will recall the time, and when, you know, we thought the end of the world was coming up. And of course, we were required, I was about, I don't know, 11 or 12 at the time. And I actually hadn't committed very many sins, hard though it may be to believe. But I must have committed a few, you know? Anyway, for better, I was forced to go out and go to confession and confess the few sins I might have had. I remember as a child, you know, being we had to go to confession every week. I don't know if some of you were brought up as Catholics, perhaps. I remember inventing sins just to have something to talk about. And then I remember actually, and this is a terrible thing to admit, and I see we're on air here. Has this been broadcast live? It's not actually been broadcast at some point, is it?
No, it's for YouTube.
Is it really? Is it really? YouTube? Well, you know, here's the thing. I remember, this is what worries me about YouTube. I think I remember committing a few sins just to have something to talk about.
Oh, you want me to stop it now?
That's all right. Don't worry about it. No, I think in the overall shape of the atrocities of the world, really, it's probably no big deal. In any case, so we have this little Catholic parish, right, college lands, a hangover from Trinity College Dublin, land that had belonged to Trinity. Was there as a kind of fossilized bit of their, you know, after the division of Ireland. It was kind of left hanging there, and these were some of the Catholic tenant farmers who were still around, who were my neighbors and my mother's students. So we've got the Catholic situation there, we've got the big picture, as it were. One of my favorite poets is Patrick Kavanagh, some of you may know, Monaghan poet, who wrote an extraordinary poem called Epic, about a dispute between two families, the Duffys and the McCames, over their where the right of way went, where the division of their land was, the march, as he calls it, who owns the march between these iron stones. And these two guys are sort of stripped to the waist. They've got the pitchfork out and the slapping hook, as they call it, for cutting hedges. And Kavanagh writes that was the year of the Munich bother, i.e. 1939, when Chamberlain, of course, Neville Chamberlain, went to Germany to see if he could do a deal with Hitler and co., which didn't quite work out. And he goes on, he says, and he sort of sets the two things, which is the more important? I inclined to lose my faith in Ballymore and Gorchin, two little townlands, when Homer's ghost came hurrying to my mind. He said, I made the Iliad of such a local row. Gods make their own importance. In other words, you know, it's hard to judge which is more important in the eternal, you know, the great schema of things, the little, what's small. So anyway, that's the context for this. Cuba. My eldest sister arrived home that morning in her white muslin evening dress. Who the hell do you think you are, running out to dances and next to nothing? As though we hadn't enough bother with the world at war, if not at an end. My father was pounding the breakfast table. Those Yankees were touch and go as it was. If you'd heard Patton in Armagh, but this Kennedy's merely an Irishman, so he's not much better than ourselves. And him with only to say the word. If you've got anything on your mind, maybe you should make your peace with God. I could hear May from beyond the curtain. Bless me, Father. I have sinned. I told a lie once. I was disobedient once. Tell me, child, was this touch immodest? Did he touch your breast, for example? He brushed against me, Father, very gently. So that, I'm afraid, is the milieu in which I was brought up. And by the way, kind of terrifying, really. And there's worse, but I don't think I'm going to linger over it. I'll tell you what, I will linger over one little moment. It's a story that was told in our house by one of my uncles, Uncle Patrick Regan. And it was a story told about the B specials. They were the, if some of you may recall, the auxiliary branch, I suppose, of the Royal Ulster Constabulary. They were extremely problematic, kind of militia that operated as a police force. Not the kind of thing that happens in this country, I'm sure. Or ever did. But, they were almost exclusively Protestant, and they seemed to delight in terrorizing their Catholic neighbors. They went around at night with their faces, hooded, masked, whatever, blacked up. Then they'd be stopping people driving along and asking who they were, knowing perfectly well who they were. They may have been working with them that day in a store or something. And generally giving them a hard time. A couple of things. The sash that I refer to is the song, the great sort of theme tune, as it were, of the Orange Order. The Orange Order, named after King William of Orange and Nassau, Prince William of Orange and Nassau, King William as he became. Of course, had a war with his father or not, James, I think was I think that was it. They were related quite closely. What do you say? Was he son-in-law? Yeah, one was the, do you remember?
James II,
I think.
His daughter was married.
Was married to William. Yeah, William and Mary. Yeah. It all comes together. In any case, a family row, basically, with international ramifications. The sash my father wore was the song. And I think that's about it. The Sightseers. My father and mother, my brother and sister and I, with Uncle Pat, our dour, best-loved uncle, had set out that Sunday afternoon in July in his broken-down Ford, not to visit some graveyard. One died of shingles, one of fever, another's knees turned to jelly, but the brand-new roundabout at Ballygall. The first in Mid-Ulster. Uncle Pat was telling us how the B specials had stopped him one night, somewhere near Ballygolly, and smashed his bicycle and made him sing the sash and curse the Pope of Rome. They held a pistol so hard against his forehead, there was still the mark of an O when he got home. Just happened to put these together. A little song lyric. They used to say, "You ought to stay down on the farm, but the grass is green. He used to say you should make hay till you lose an arm to a mowing machine. Now they say that you can fly twice a day from Dublin to Dubai. Let's go back to living on the edge. Let's go back to how it used to be. Let's go back to living on the edge. I want you to stay with staying with me. They used to say you ought to stay within the sound of church bells or the factory horn. They used to say you should wait for a ray to break through to your cell one December morn. Now they say that you can fly twice a day from Galway. And of course, that's the point, as you know, in the structure of most songs, where something different has to happen. We went to the middle eight of the bridge, and it goes from Galway to the Galapagos and gallop there through Vulcan's Forge. Maybe even let down your hair with a tortoise called Lonesome George. We were recording this last night, actually. Did someone want some water there? Would someone like some? You get? We were recording this last night in a studio which I just come from, and one of the people involved was Catch O'Riordan, the great bass player from the Pogues, and she had been she revealed that she'd met Lonesome George, who was, and perhaps some of you have, he lived to, as my father would have said, he lived to a big age, maybe 200 or 300. What? He's no Lonesome George. Anyway, the song is called Lonesome George. They used to say, and then we go back, they used to say you ought to stay with your seed and breed on a moonlit hill. They used to say 6 feet of clay is all you need to be promised in a will. Now they say that you can fly twice a day from Shannon to Shanghai. Let's go back to living by our pledge. Let's go back to how it used to be. Let's go back to living by our pledge. I want you to stay with me. So, let me see. I'm just sort of finding my way around this book here, which is just, I just put it together yesterday. Well, I didn't put it together yesterday. I printed it out yesterday. These are the proofs of it. Maybe we'll go up a little bit. I'll read a poem set. Actually, I'll read a poem set on East 79th Street. Why not? The local. You know? The Duffys and the Kids. My father-in-law has been very generous to me throughout my life in America, which is now 30 years. And one of the first presents he gave me was of a briefcase. And when we lived along the street here, I was teaching in Columbia and Princeton at the time, so, you know, part-time in each. And I'd be sending out for Columbia, and I'd have my bits and pieces in a Dalek bag or something. And I think he looked at me. I'm sure he looked at me once or twice for various reasons, but I think in this case he looked at me and he said, I think he thought, no, he should have more than, he should be doing better than that. So he presented me with a fabulous eel skin briefcase. And I mean, this This was in 1987, and even on 79th Street, I mean, to be walking down the street with an eel-skin briefcase, purple, I think was some kind of statement was being made. And it's not inconceivable that the statement was, come and kill me. Or something along those lines. I really don't know. That was part of his plan all along. Very good. I wrote this poem, I dedicated it to Seamus Heaney, who, of course, was the great poet of eels. I mean, one of the things about trying to write poems, as many of you will know, is that there are certain topics that, you know, if you embark on writing a poem about a flea, say, it's probably advisable if one lets it be known in some way that one knows that John Donne wrote kind of the first and last poem about a flea. I mean, I think if you're writing a poem just about the animal kingdom, if you're writing a poem about a moose, probably just as well to somehow acknowledge Elizabeth Bishop there, you know, in some way. Just that, in case you look like a complete idiot, which one probably will anyway, but, you know, just to sort of preempt that in some ways. In any case, what would the briefcase, yeah, let me just see here. So anyway, this is a poem about the briefcase, and one of the wonderful things I discovered, the power of the forces in the world, including the eel, which of course is a remarkable animal, as you know, and spends, you know, travels from the Sargasso Sea right across the Atlantic into Europe, for example. Goes in other directions too. extraordinary voyagers. So many of these animals are. In fact, I'll read a poem about a bird, which in a minute, which of course goes from Chile to the Arctic. But the eel moves around, and there's a feeling, at least there was a feeling then, that part of its success has to do with the fact that there's some kind of magnetic component in its body, and it was able to sort of align itself with this and that. You know, I wrote a poem a couple of years ago, which I didn't think was in this, so I won't be bothering you with it. I don't think it made it in. No, a poem about a dung beetle, which, as you know, well, perhaps you haven't learned this. I was astonished to discover the dung beetle, the humble dung beetle or scarab beetle, steers by the stars. It moves around. I mean, people have done a lot of work on the dung beetle, as you might imagine, and. You know, one of the, I think they put something over one of its eyes. It's a terrible thing to do to a poor animal. And they figured out that it must steer by a visual. Right? Fascinating. Anyway, the magnetic, here's the thing though, the magnetic strip in the, is this even relevant? It's not. I was going to say, one of the great fears about this eel skin briefcase was that it was going to demagnetize credit cards, as was the case with eel skin wallets. But actually, I've noticed that's not in the poem, so let's forget about that. Anyway, so you've got it, East 79th Street, standing on a waiting for the crosstown bus. The briefcase. I held the briefcase at arm's length from me. The ox blood or liver, eel skin, with which it was covered, had suddenly grown supple. I've been waiting in line for the crosstown bus when an almighty cloud burst left the sidewalk a raging torrent. And though it contained only the first inkling of this poem, I knew I daren't set the briefcase down to slap my pockets for an obol, for fear it might slink into a culvert and strike out along the East River for the sea, by which I mean the open sea. Now that's a poem that we have to be, one would have to say, belongs to the slightly wackier end of the spectrum. In those poems I was reading, have sort of beginnings, middles, and ends, roughly in that order, but not all of them do. And that one, for example, the open sea, why bother with that? I suppose it's somewhat to do with at least a raging torrent there that we find. It's probably this kind of indicator that something slightly out of the ordinary is happening. One could probably have a raging torrent in a song lyric, but maybe not in a poem that's sort of taken itself demi-semi seriously, or wants to be. In any case, you know, if at any point you'd like to make an observation, raise a concern, talk to these people. Please feel free to ask me if there's anything let me just go to the wackier end of the spectrum now, completely wacky end of the spectrum, because I'm fascinated by the tradition of nonsense poetry. There's a huge tradition of nonsense poems. This is one. It's called Symposium. A symposium, as you know, Plato's Symposium, a philosophical discussion taking place over a what? No, go ahead. We're all family here. Well, a dinner with wine.
Wine, of course, wine.
A dinner with wine. So over a drink. Philosophical discussion over a drink. Now, it's possible, it's quite conceivable that the person who speaks this poem, which is not me, by the way, and also it's not necessarily me, myself, the historical personage such as I am, who spoke any of those poems, indeed. Right? Or who described various activities and events. Someone came to me once and said, "How's May?" I said, "May? Yeah. Who's May?"
"My sister."
"My sister." I said, "I'm sorry, I'm terribly sorry, but actually, I don't have a sister called May. She's completely May, that's May." They were very disappointed in me. But you know, one of the things about writing poetry is that you can have a life that's more interesting than one's own life. But otherwise, why? You know what I'm saying? No sister, May. Symposium. So it's possible that the speaker of this may have had two, perhaps up to three glasses of wine. You can lead, and we're talking about cliches here, truisms, proverbs. You can lead a horse to water, but you can't make it hold its nose to the grindstone and hunt with the hounds. Every dog has a stitch in time. Two heads, you've been sold one good turn. One good turn deserves a bird in the hand. A bird in the hand is better than no bread. To have your cake is to hey, Paul, make hay while you can still hit the nail on the head. For want of a nail, the sky might People in glass houses can't see the wood for the new broom. Rome wasn't built between two stools. Empty vessels wait for no man. A hair of the dog is a friend indeed. There's no fool like the fool who shot his bolt. There's no smoke after the horse is gone. So I promise a little family, a little poem about the bird. Round about the 20th of May, for many years, though it's been changing a little bit with, you know, the various upsets in the world as weather. Imagine decades, centuries perhaps, or perhaps millennia. You could set your clock, or indeed millions of years. You could set your clock beyond millennia, is what I mean by that. You could set your clock by the red knots coming into Delaware Bay. Do you remember? More or less, pretty much every year of 20th of May, which happens to be the birthday of our son. And there's not a lot more to say about it than that. And that's good. In a strange way, the less to be said about a poem, the better. You know the little bird, the red knot? The day our son is due is the very day the red knots are meant to touch down on their long haul from Chile to the Arctic Circle, where they'll nest on the tundra within a few feet of where they were hatched. 40,000 or 50,000 of them are meant to drop in along Delaware. They time their arrival on these shores to coincide with the horseshoe crabs laying their eggs in the sand. Smallish birds to begin with, the red knots have now lost half their weight. Eating the eggs of the horseshoe crabs is what gives them the strength to go on. 40,000 or 50,000 of them getting up all at once as if for a rock concert encore. Well, here's another bird, one of my favourites, turkey buzzards. This is a fairly harrowing poem. I'll read this and I'll read maybe a couple more, and then we'll be what time is it there?
7:20.
7:20. Well, can we go another wee one? Another minute or two? Yeah, briefly. Yeah. So this is a rather harrowing poem. It's a poem about the turkey buzzard. At least it began by being about the turkey buzzard, one of the great animals. I mean, it sort of puts even the dung beetle, possibly even the red knot, you know, it puts a lot of things in the shade, but it's such an extraordinary animal. I mean, the mystery is how do they manage to keep on? How do they live after what they eat? You know, and people are studying, there are lots of people studying the turkey buzzard and trying to figure out how its stomach works. As you may know, it's a bird that began in Florida. It was more or less exclusive to the southeastern states. But what with the development of the roundabouts that we were hearing about earlier on, in this country and the great interstate, bless you, system that Eisenhower put in place. The turkey buzzard, as you will see if you look up, possibly even now, has done very well. It has availed of the great cafeteria style. Is it? It's not a laundromat. What's the say?
Automat.
Kind of the automat. Buffet. They're running kind of buffet on the interstate. Anyway, so I started off to write a poem just to try to learn a little bit more. I mean, most poems, certainly for me, I'm trying to figure something out. I don't know what it is. I don't know what the question is. And then really, in a way, only in discovering what the answer is do I discover what the question might have been. Mm-hmm. Right? Never know what I'm doing. So I sort of started out here, though with an image or two, the kettle, which is the technical term for a group of buzzards, a kettle. A kettle. Now most sane people would just have said kettle and moved on to the next poem, but it's a bit short. So anyway, as I was writing it, as I was writing it. My sister, emerged really, was coming towards the end of her life. She died from ovarian cancer, as my mother had. So her predicament really sort of overwhelmed this poem and sort of became inextricably bound up, as they say, the two strands. And many poems, including many of mine, or maybe even most of them, have to do with two things happening at once. I mentioned Donald's Flea the other earlier on. So taking an outrageous connection between things. You know, the flea is the marriage bed. And running with that, the extended metaphor, the metaphysical conceit, is at the heart of many of them. So in this case, though, the two strains or strands came together in some way. So I'm going to read this and maybe one more, and that should see us there. If you would like a conversation, that would be great too. Turkey buzzards. This is a one sentence poem. I don't know why I mentioned that. It's just that as I advance in years, and you know, there's always a question of whether or not I'll get through it. We'll see. Turkey buzzards, they've been so long above it all. Those two petals, so steeped in style, they seem to stall in the kettle, simmering over the town dump. Or, better still, the neon-flashed, X-rated rump of fresh roadkill, courtesy of the interstate, that Eisenhower would overtake in the home straight by 1 horsepower. The kettle, where it all boils down to the thick scent of death. A scent of such renown, it's given vent to the idea buzzards can spot a deer carcass a mile away, smelling the rot as once Marcus Aurelius wrinkled his nose at a gas leak from the great sewer that ran through Rome to the Tiber. Then, when searching out through the gloom, one subscriber to the other view, that the rose, full bloom, antique, its no frills rough, the 6-foot shrug of its swing wings, the theologians and the thugs, twin triumphings, in a buzzard's shaved head and smooth buzz, buzz, buzzy. Its logic, in all likelihood, somewhat fuzzy, would ever come into focus, it ever deign to dispense its hocus pocus in that same vein as runs along an inner thigh to where to write the buzzard vouchsafes not to shy away from shite, its mission not to give a miss to a bête noir, all roly-poly, full of piss and vinegar, trying rather to get to grips with the grommet of the gut, setting its tin snips to that grommet in the spray-painted hind's hind gut, and making a sweeping, too right, a sweeping cut that's so blasé, it's hard to imagine, dear sis, why others shrink from this sight of a soul in bliss. So in the pink from another month, in the red of the shambles, like a rose in over its head among brambles. Unflappable in its belief, its Ararat on which the ark would come to grief. Abjuring that Marcus Aurelius humbug about what springs from earth, succumbing to the tug at its heartstrings, reported to live past 50, as you yet may, dear sis, perhaps growing your hair in requital, though briefly, of whatever tears at your vitals, learning, perhaps, from the nifty, nay, thrifty way. These buzzards are given to stoop and take their ease by letting their time-chastened poop fall to their knees till they're almost as bright with lime as their night roost, their poop containing an enzyme that's known to boost their immune systems. Should they prong themselves on small bones round a cerebral cortex, at no small cost to their well-being, sinking fast in a deer crypt. Buzzards getting the hang, at last, of being stripped of their command off the vortex, while having lost their common touch. They've been so long above it all. So I think maybe just thank you very much indeed. Thank you, thank you. I think we can't possibly end on that note. It's too much. And I thank you for your any observations, queries, questions, concerns that you might have, and then I'm going to end with one. Yes?
This is meant to be humorful. You referred to that briefcase as purple, and I'm thinking to myself, this guy's walking down the street with a bright purple briefcase.
Well, purplish, yeah. Maroon, perhaps.
Yes, it makes a very personal statement. Mm-hmm. And then I found out it was Oxblood.
I'm not good on colours, I'm really not. Yes. Oxblood, yeah. Oxblood it is, yeah. I think that's right. It's sort of part, I do, you know what, I do have it. I've kept very close over the years. Yeah, I still have it, despite the dangers attached to it, you know. I suppose I'm interested in things having a life of their own, and indeed, if you recall, what's in the briefcase is the first inkling of the poem, which includes the briefcase, right? So I suppose in some sense I'm committed to the idea that the poems are not written by me, for example. They're written through me. They're not by me. I'm just being used, if anything, by them. I'm sure many of you have that experience of having read something that you wrote at one point, and I certainly read things and that I wrote, you know, an essay or something. Couldn't possibly have written that. I mean, one of the things I think is I'm not smart enough to have written that. You know? that, there's that feeling, and that's true of the poems too. It's something else, you know, another force in the world. Yes.
Did you ever write a poem that you didn't revise at all, that just sort of came and you left it?
Well, the question was, did I ever write a poem that I didn't revise at all? They're all revised. But my way of revising is a little bit strange compared to what many people do, which is that I revise as I write. I don't write drafts. I write the first line, I don't leave the first line until it's done. Of course, that's a complex idea, because in the verse business, what we're taught, the very essence of the verse business is the point at which line one becomes line two. That's what it's all about. The verses. Why it turns, how it turns, that's at the heart of the enterprise. And the reason why it does that, of course, there must be some reason why it does that. So I just write one at a time, one line at a time pretty much. That's not to say I don't go back and change things, of course I do. But in general, very few things have ever come out quickly or easily. In fact, I'm a very slow writer, I'd say. And partly because I don't think it's quite natural to me. You know, I need to work. So the simplest things in particular, when I can't write an email, for example, if I'm writing an email that says, see you at 6 o'clock, well, wait a minute, is that the best way of saying that? Looking forward to meeting you around 6. And I think, well, wait a minute. And it goes on like that. And it's one of the reasons why most of my emails are one sentence long, and I've spent half an hour writing them. It's terrible. And that's all they don't say anything much deeper than see you at 6 o'clock. But it's the curse of being a verse writer. You know, you don't expect to write easily. Now, my wife is a very adept writer, a very fluent writer. I just can't do that at all. It just takes me a long time to write a sentence. Forever. Any other thoughts? Yes?
I'm sorry, what was the title of that last poem that you just read about the turkey buzzards?
It's called Turkey Buzzards. The title is a mysterious thing. I mean, it's a fascinating business. You know, in that case, it's just straight up Turkey Buzzards. You know? What do you say? Sometimes that's the best thing. With my students, for example, half the time we don't know what poems are about, and if we were just quite direct as poets and said, this is what it's about, we get into this situation where we've been educated to believe that poems are never about what they seem to be about. They're always about something else, right? They're encoded in some ways. So when we come to write poems, then we think, well, I can't just say turkey buzzards. It's too boring. It's too obvious. No, seriously. Let me call it something else. You know, creatures of the Empyrean. the finny tribe. That's fish. Whatever. It's translated into poetry. Now, that's not to say that there aren't times when things are not absolutely direct. Of course they're not. But often it's just the best and simplest thing to do. Yes?
Do you acknowledge anybody else who's written a poem about the dumb people before you?
I don't know. One of the things that one of the reasons for reading is that the more one knows, the better. And the more one knows about dumb people's, and the more one has a sense that there might be a whole tradition of dung beetle poems. This, not that I'm aware of, but...
I and...
Do you know some yourself?
No.
I mean, like, the minute one says that, I mean, somebody, like, when I think of the collected poems of D.H. Lawrence, for example, which are, you know, never mind the novels and all the rest of it, the poems are about so thick, as you know. It's extraordinary. He could easily have written one. I mean, it's the kind of thing that he would have done. He was a brilliant, brilliant poet of the Egyptians. Well, that's right. Well, they were sacred, of course, the scarab people of Rome.
Could you read us the
poem? You know, I don't have it. No, because it didn't. I would say I've just done this little selector. There's a very consistent five poems from each of the 12 books I did. And it's not in it, so far as I know. It may have been in it. No. It's not there. But maybe I'll read a short poem to end. And. I'll read a little song lyric if you don't mind, just come out of a slight. What is that? A slightly different. I gave the Pope a rhino that had tossed on its. Well, first of all, thank you so much for having us here. It's a great pleasure to be in the building with you. Thank you for coming out and for staying out. And I hope you enjoy the rest of your evening. I gave the Pope a rhino that had tossed on its horn the leopard from Inferno, the night our vows were sworn. Hey, by the way, I don't think any of these songs are going to be in the top 10. In any case, that's another matter. For being staunch doesn't mean you can't launch an all-out attack, though it may rush through the underbrush, at least it's still on track. I gave the Pope a rhino to show which path is true. Everything that's left, I'll give to you. Dedicated to my mother. I gave the Tsar a sturgeon. From the Caspian Sea. We associate the region with instability. But doubling the locks may well replenish stocks in the longer term. Though its hold is slender, we're told, at least its grasp is firm. I gave the Tsar a sturgeon to show what's been renewed. Everything that's left, I'll give to you. My bow, and here's the bridge then, of burning gold. My scrip of joy, immortal diet. A bar of soap I stole from the Hyannis Port Hyatt Regency. A fingernail of Charms the Bold, a first edition of Johnny Panic. First class dinner roll from the RMS Titanic, lost at sea. Rembrandt's recipe for raw umber, a bamboo strainer and a sieve to catch prime numbers, a bootlace tie worn by a spiv in E2. A bootleg of the expensive winos, a tortoise we've so far outlived, a spare black rhino. Everything that's left, I'll give to you, to you, to you, to you. That sounds better, son. I gave the prince a diamond I picked up in the grass. He may yet seize the moment through a pane of glass. We know that to cower in a crystal tower makes it hard to find a match. Though he's barely touched the surface as such, at least that surface is scratched. I gave the prince a diamond to show how to cut through his name.